Shalom, Marta Clifford Nagayaho, Nagatilakum Chinook, Cree, member of Confederated Tribes of Grand Ronde, Nagashlushdamdam Kaba, Yagwa Mithlite Kaba, and Saga Kaba Kalapuya Ilihi. Hi, I'm Marta Clifford. My people are Chinook and Cree, and I'm a member of the Confederated Tribes of Grand Ronde. I'm so happy to be here tonight with you on Kalapuya land. We're going to now say our opening prayer. Hayumasi Seyale Tayi. Kaba Uksan, Ankati Tilakam, Nehwa, Maga Yeham, Nsaga Hayumasi, Kana Itka. Thank you, Creator, for this day to come together. And thank you, ancestors, for everything. Please help us to take care of each other during these trying times. Help us to always look out for our elders and our children. Guide us to be good caretakers of our Mother Earth. Please watch over us as we take care of the water, the trees, and all the non-humans on this land. They need our help in order to survive. Watch over us tonight as we come together. Help us to be kind and forgiving of each other always. Ancestors, please help us. Thank you for everything. Haimasa sehili tahi.
Yokoke Marta, I'm Brian Klopotic. I'm a Chakta, halito everybody. And I'm a professor at University of Oregon. And I'm here with...
Osione God, Kirby Brown, Dapato, Yone Ganti. My name is Kirby Brown. I'm a citizen of the Cherokee Nation and also an associate professor here at the University of Oregon.
So we're going to start tonight with a greeting song, a Klamath greeting song that was taught to us by Gordon Bettles, who is the steward of the Many Nations Longhouse at the University of Oregon. And he was taught this song on the condition that he teach it to everybody without any restrictions on it. And he taught it to all of us. And we're so grateful for our opportunity to sing this song on this special occasion as well. So the song in Klamath would be translated as, I change you, you change me. So it's a greeting song that acknowledges that when we meet together, we are all changed by that process, whether it's one-on-one or as a group, we're all changed by that process. So we'll just go ahead and sing the song. Thank you, everybody, for joining us.
Wado.
Good evening. My name is Marcelyn Burke, and I'm the Dean and Dave Frommeyer Chair in Leadership and Law here at the University of Oregon. And it is my distinct pleasure to welcome you this evening on behalf of the Law School, the University of Oregon, the Environmental and Natural Resources Law Center, the Native American Studies Program, the Native American Law Students Association, and the Wayne Moore Center for Law and Politics. Tonight is our 15th annual Renard Strickland Lecture. And as I begin this welcome, I'd like to acknowledge that the University of Oregon is located on Kalapuya Ilahi land, the traditional indigenous homeland of the Kalapuya people. Following treaties of between 1851 and 1855, Kalapuya people were dispossessed of their indigenous homeland by the United States government and forcibly moved to the Coast Reservation in Western Oregon. Today, descendants of the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde, the community of Oregon and Confederated Tribes of the Siletz Indians of Oregon, also continue to make very important contributions here in Oregon, as well as at the University of Oregon and across the land that we all know as Oregon. We express our respect for all federally recognized tribal nations of Oregon, and those include the Burns Paiute Tribe, the Confederated Tribes of the Coos, Lower Umpqua and Siuslaw Indians, the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde Community of Oregon, the Confederated Tribes of the Siletz Indians of Oregon, the Confederated Tribes of the Umatilla Indian Reservation, the Confederated Tribes of Warm Springs, the Coquille Indian Tribe, the Cow Creek Band of Umpqua Tribe of Indians, and the Klamath Tribes. We also express our respect for all displaced Indigenous people who call Oregon home. So before we proceed with our speakers this evening, I'd like to take a moment to recognize and acknowledge the incomparable Renard Strickland. We are all saddened by the loss of Renard. Indeed, tonight, this is the first lecture since his passing last January. And yet we are so grateful that we had set aside this time each year to gather and remember and honor his remarkable accomplishments. As a preeminent scholar and author in the field of Native American law, Renard published more than 40 books and numerous articles and chapters. He acted as editor-in-chief of the 1982 revision, Cohen's Handbook on Federal Indian Law, as well as a member of the editorial board of that 2005 revision. Dean Strickland was a legend in the legal education field, and he served in leadership roles in the American Association of Law Schools and the Society of American Law Teachers. Perhaps most astonishing to me is the fact that Dean Renard Strickland was the dean at 4 law schools. Yes, 4 law schools, including, of course, the University of Oregon School of Law. Dean Strickland was an incredible gift to Oregon law's community and his service as professor and dean. And I would add on a personal note, as a mentor to me, who very early on in my academic career told me that I could do this job. And now I stand where he once stood. So in recognition of his incredible accomplishments, the ENR Center created the Renard Strickland Lecture. Professor Mary Wood, our faculty director for the ENR Center, will speak in just a moment about the origins of this lecture. But I just wanted to pause and note how important this event is to our entire community, as it provides us an opportunity to discuss, explore, and advance Native environmental sovereignty issues in our state, in our region, in the nation, and indeed in the world. So with that, I say again, welcome to the 15th annual. And I now turn the program over to Professor Mary Wood.
Thank you so much, Dean, and welcome everybody. Part of Renard's lasting legacy at University of Oregon Law School is this annual Renard Strickland Lecture, now in its 15th year. The Native Environmental Sovereignty Project, which is a project of our Environmental Natural Resources Law Center, created this lecture series to honor Renard's legacy and to build on his contributions to the field of law, to legal education, and to the programs in our law school. This lecture series examines Native leadership and vision for environmental stewardship in the 21st century. It is a tremendous honor to be here tonight, and it was a tremendous honor to have delivered the first inaugural Renard Strickland lecture, which I entitled EPA's Protection of Tribal Harvest, Braiding the Agency's Mission. Now, with climate crisis bearing down upon our whole world, there has never been a more important time for Native nations to exercise their sovereign leadership in showing pathways forward. As Renard wrote in his landmark work, Tonto's Revenge, if there is to be a post-Columbian future, a future for any of us, it will be an Indian future, a world in which this time the superior worldview might even hope to compete with, if not triumph over, technology. We are tremendously honored to have Professor Stacy Leeds with us this evening to deliver this year's Renard Strickland Lecture. Professor Kirby Brown, who you have already seen, will be introducing Professor Leeds in a few moments. But before we turn to that, we would like to show a brief video montage that honors Renard. In it, three past Renard Strickland lecturers share their remembrances about Renard and reflect on his contributions to the field of Indian law. They are Dean Kevin Washburn, Patrice Kanesh, and Professor Carol Goldberg.
Un momento.
Hi, my name is Kevin Washburn. I'm the Dean of the University of Iowa College of Law, and I'm an old friend of Renard's. I don't know how you do a short video tribute to someone who was the dean in five law schools and wrote 35 or some number of books, but let me just say just a few words about my own appreciation for Renard. He was a great mentor to me. He got me involved as chair. Well, he got me involved in the Law School Admission Council that he was chair, and because I got involved, became very engaged in that. I later became the chair, so I succeeded him 2 decades later or so when he served as chair. And that's been really rewarding. I got to spend a lot of time with Renard over the years through that activity. Renard had a best friend, Charles Blackwell, who was also deceased, who was a member of my tribe and was my tribe, the Chickasaw Nation's ambassador to the United States in Washington, D.C. And Renard and Charles used to talk on Sunday mornings, very early on Sunday mornings. They were very early risers. But they would talk, and if I ever had any issues, I would just feed them to Charles before Sunday, and Charles and Renard would wrestle with those issues on Sunday morning, and then later on Sunday or later that week, Charles would call me back, and I would get the answer, the solution to my problems. That happened numerous times, and gave the best of the wisdom of both of them was really, really helpful. And they were just great friends, and I was mentored very well by both. Miss both of them very much, but Renard was a joy to have as a mentor, and I'm lucky to be one of the former Renard Strickland lecturers at the University of Oregon. You're having a great program, and I'm sorry I can't be with you today. Thank you.
And thank you, Wash Day, and thank you, Wash Day. Good day, all my relatives. I'm Patrice Kunish. I was a presenter of the 6th Renard Strickland Lecture in 2012, which seems like a really long time ago. The title of my lecture was Power Paths, Environmentally Sustainable Economic Development in Indian Country, a topic that continues to resonate loudly today. It is quite an honor to be invited to share a few thoughts about Renard Strickland and his impact on my career and many others over the years. One of my favorite quotes from Renard is that lawyers are the foot soldiers of our Constitution. I've thought about that quote recently for a number of reasons, especially when I consider Supreme Court decisions such as McGirt and Brackeen. Renard was one of the foremost warriors in federal Indian law. He once remarked that the Native American struggle for survival since Europeans arrived in North America has not been one of isolated conflicts, but rather an intellectual, legal, and cultural battle. Renard's weapon of choice was his keen intellect. He took on that 500-year legal battle and changed the arc of an entire field of law. He poured his brilliant knowledge of history and law into revising Felix Cohen's Handbook on Federal Indian Law, now an indispensable treatise to lawyers and judges alike. He also worked steadfastly to fortify Native American identity, cultural values, and of course, sovereignty. I felt this impact most demonstrably in Justice Gorsuch's McGirt decision, where he began, "On the far end of the Trail of Tears was a promise." And with these powerful words, the court reaffirmed that the federal government must honor its promises set out in treaties, which means that Indian country still exists in Oklahoma. I'd like to think that I've also been a worthy warrior on behalf of Native nations and people. Whatever contributions I've made, though, I know that 500 years from now, Native people and cultures will remain strong because of Renard Strickland's enduring contributions. Thank you.
As honored as I was to be invited to present the lecture that was named for my esteemed and beloved colleague Renard, and as delighted as I was to engage with the faculty and students at University of Oregon Law School, the real highlight of my lectureship in 2016 was the opportunity it afforded to dine and visit with Renard himself. Dining with Renard always meant entering his wonderful world of fascinating personalities, cultural insights, witticisms, grand dreams, and plentiful laughs. An invariable accompaniment to it all was exquisite cuisine. But my first encounter with Renard was in connection with the project to revise Felix Cohen's 1942 classic treatise, The Handbook of Federal Indian Law. The 1968 Indian Civil Rights Act had directed the Secretary of the Interior to get that handbook updated, and the Secretary eventually connected with a board of editors to be led by Renard as editor-in-chief. That board began its work in 1975. At that time, I was still only 3 years into my position as an untenured faculty member at UCLA Law School. And I will always be grateful to Renard for having the faith and confidence in me, the youngest and the only woman asked to participate in that group of 9 Indian law scholars. The next 6 years of intense collaboration on the handbook, led by Renard, provided the most enlightening and exhilarating education in Indian law imaginable. From those who literally built the discipline and the modern-day advocacy organizations for Indian law. As editor-in-chief and the only Native person on the board, Renard was many things. He was intellectual leader and guide and referee, but he was also moral compass and coach. Indelibly inked in my memory are the motivational letters that he periodically sent to the board as the difficulty and the complexity of our task increased, and the work stretched out beyond 5 years. During that time, the United States Supreme Court was delivering blow after blow to the cause of tribal sovereignty. And it's important to remember that we were being asked to reaffirm and extend the positions taken by Felix Cohen for the handbook at the same time that the U.S. Supreme Court was systematically contradicting them in cases that have often been described as the most detrimental decisions to tribal interests of the modern era. These are trying circumstances, and under those circumstances, Renard's epistles did a remarkable job of sustaining our spirits, not to mention our faith in justice and the rule of law. Most pointedly, he insisted that Native nations were ancient civilizations that had been around for millennia before Europeans arrived, surviving natural disasters and intergroup conflicts, and they would likewise survive the most recent assaults on their lands and sovereignty from the American legal system. We must take the longer view, he reminded us all of this, and we should not become discouraged by temporary setbacks. His words have been vindicated many, many times over as tribes have achieved economic, political, and legal victories counteracting those Supreme Court losses. I miss Renard tremendously, but I will always be sustained by his words and his spirit.
Fantastic.
All right, kapai, slahayam, shech pashwai, daisla, waklisi, halito, osio, nigada. Hello and welcome everyone. My name is Kirby Brown. And as I said earlier, I'm a citizen of the Cherokee Nation and an associate professor of Native American and Indigenous literature at the University of Oregon. As a citizen of a tribal nation from Oklahoma, who was born and raised on Numina and Kiowa territory in West Texas, and who now lives and works in the Willamette Valley, it is a privilege to welcome you this evening from what was, is, and always will be Kalapuya Ilahi. As Director of Native American and Indigenous Studies and in partnership with the UO School of Law, I am super excited to introduce Professor Stacy Leeds as the 2021 Renard Strickland Lecturer in Indigenous Environmental Law. Professor Leeds is an accomplished scholar, educator, and administrator in Indigenous law and policy, who has held numerous positions in both legal and academic contexts in a wide array of institutions, organizations, and tribal nations across the country. Most recently, Professor Leeds retired from a 7-year term as dean at the University of Arkansas School of Law, where she became the first Indigenous woman in the US to hold such a position, and has now joined the faculty at the Sandra Day O'Connor College of Law at Arizona State University as the founding foundation professor of law and leadership. Stacy has directed law and governance programs at the University of Kansas and the University of North Dakota, and has been recognized with the Spirit of Excellence Award by the American Bar Association. As a model for how to connect academic work to the needs and priorities of tribal communities, Professor Leeds has also served as a justice on the Cherokee Nation Supreme Court, as a district court judge for the Muscogee Creek Nation, and as an appellate judge for a number of other Indigenous nations across the country. Like her mentor, for whom this lecture series is named, Stacy herself has mentored countless students and young legal scholars inside and outside the academy, working not only to carve out her own path, but also to bring as many others along with her as possible. I first came to know Stacy's work as a young-ish literary and cultural studies scholar in the mid-2000s. Since that time, her legal opinions and scholarship on questions of sovereignty, citizenship, and governance in the Cherokee Nation and across Indian country have become formative to my own work on early 20th century Cherokee nationhood and the central role of law, policy, governance, and story to that story. Stacy's recent work on the 2020 Supreme Court decision, McGirt v. Oklahoma, about which she will speak this evening, brings into sharp relief the impacts and implications of one of the most important decisions affirming tribal sovereignty and the trust relationship between Indigenous nations and the US government in recent memory. That she does so as the most recent Cherokee legal scholar to hold this space alongside the late former Principal Chief Wilma Mankiller and fellow Cherokee lawyer and scholar Mary Catherine Nagel makes this evening, for this Cherokee anyway, that much more special. I could talk about Stacy for hours, including the fact that she's as strong a teammate and as fierce a competitor on the softball diamond and the basketball court as she is in the courtroom or classroom, but I'll stop for now. Please join me in providing a warm UO and Kalapuya Ilahi welcome to Professor Stacy Leeds, the 2021 Renard Strickland Lecture in Indigenous Law.
Osio Nagata, Stacy Leeds, Dawado, Tijalagi. Hello, everyone. I'm Stacy Leeds, and I am a citizen of the Cherokee Nation, and I'm coming to you tonight from Tahlequah, the capital of the Cherokee Nation. It is truly an honor to be invited to give this lecture, particularly this year, as we celebrate the life and the legacy of Renard. Renard and I share a hometown. We're both Okies from Muskogee. And as you can tell from my still somewhat youthful disposition, Renard and I were not of the same generation. In fact, I did not personally get to know him until after I was an attorney. I was in the Hasty Fellowship Program pursuing an LLM at Wisconsin Law School, preparing to go on the teaching market. At that time, I knew of him as the Indian law icon that he was, but I did not know him as a real person. And that changed for me in one phone call. Email was still fairly new, and you could send messages and never expect to have the immediate real-time response that we have, for better or worse, become accustomed to. And so I sent an email when he was dean at Oregon Law School, introducing myself, telling him that I had aspirations to be a law professor, and that as a precursor to going on the law school teaching market, I had been advised by the folks at Wisconsin to make sure that the scholars in the Indian law field had me on their radar and knew the timing of my job search. He wrote back instantly, which was unheard of at that time for email. And whether it was true or not, he told me that I was already on his radar. And he asked if we could have an immediate phone call right then and there. And then almost an hour later, we finally hung up. And I knew for many reasons that that phone call was a special one. And I wouldn't fully realize until later on when I became a law school dean myself, just how generous an impromptu hour really was. I knew for many reasons that this was a special phone call because of some of the responses that I had from other people in our field. Several of those emails I sent out to our icons in the field went unanswered or with a large delay. And others replied with either a good luck message, or there were those that gave the real talk, explaining to me that it was a tall order that I would ever become a law professor. And I knew that. But with Renard, all things were possible. And they weren't just possible, they were highly likely to happen. He was that type of optimist. One thing that Renard enjoyed was a good spirited back and forth exchange, particularly if there was good food and wine involved. And as big of an intellectual presence and personality as he was, he uniquely didn't mind at all being pressed or challenged in his thinking, even where somebody may have told him that he was wrongheaded about something. He was fine with that, even from the most junior people in our field and in their careers. And so during the course of what turned into an over 20-year relationship, there were many things that I took him to task for, and he always took it in good nature. First of all, I told him that he wrote too much about all those dang Cherokee men, right? And that Cherokee women were a little bit more invisible in his books and stories than they should have been, particularly in light of his very strong friendship that evolved with Wilma Mankiller, that he needed to do better. And he did. He followed through. Second, I told him that he needed to dial down a notch his celebration and reverence for the State of Sequoia movement, the attempt of the five tribes to form their own state and get it approved by Congress just ahead of the state of Oklahoma, or more realistically, as a final Hail Mary attempt to block Oklahoma's admission into the Union. And if Sequoia would have happened, the five tribes would have agreed and consented to their own termination and it would have actually been a final act that was then irreversible. And we wouldn't have had the resurgence and the revitalization of modern tribal governments that we see today, because all of those treaty-based legal arguments would then have been off the table. We talked about how he and all of us needed to look at those things with a more critical eye and make sure that we all engage in a full narrative in a way that the Angie DeBose and the Grant Formans were not capable of doing, given their time in history and also their limited perspective. Conceptually and legally, there could have never been a McGirt versus Oklahoma inside the state of Sequoia. And so, of course, he always took these things in stride, and he usually responds by going over and one-upping, you know, these types of challenges. In April of 2006, he invited me and several other of the junior scholars at that time out to Oregon for a conference that was entitled From the Warrior Viewpoint, The Next Generation of Indian Law and Policy. It was co-sponsored also by the Wayne Morse Center for Law and Politics and the law school there. And it was the beginning of Renard starting to pass the Indian law baton over to a bunch of tribal citizen law professors, judges, and advocates. And he knew that when the power to shape the narrative shifted to different perspectives, it would be a different and more well-rounded narrative eventually. And this type of self-awareness that he had, we should all be so lucky as to have that in the twilight of our own careers. And as he told us that our version of Indian law would be a much different version than what he had witnessed and participated in, he was so correct, right? Enter McGirt versus Oklahoma. A conclusion that, although legally correct, if you look at the plain language of the treaties and the other laws that actually exist on the books, scholars in Renard's generation, no matter how optimistic they were, never thought that we would see this day, because the practical realities of their time and the profound power imbalance that they watched throughout Indian country looked very different during most of their lives and during the peak points in their career. And if Renard were here tonight, he would be disappointed if I didn't highlight some of the things that I wish he had talked about more and highlight the parts of Indian Territory legal history to present narratives that he may have amplified differently. So here goes. My talk is entitled Oil and Gas, an Oklahoma Origin Story and McGirt. I think most people have an idea that land and natural resources are at the core of Oklahoma's origin story. In order for Oklahoma to exist as a state in the federal union, in a place where 38 federally recognized indigenous nations have their modern homelands, it required the attempted complete colonization of tribes as political and government entities, and the dispossession of a whole lot of individual indigenous people and their lands. What I don't think even most lawyers of America and students of American Indian history fully grasp is just how deep that story actually runs, and how disingenuous a story had to be told for generations for us to get to the point where otherwise educated adults would say with a straight face that the McGirt versus Oklahoma decision decided by the United States Supreme Court in July of 2020 was completely out of the blue. And for those of you not familiar with the McGirt decision, I will try to do this in just one single paragraph. So here goes. It is a post-conviction appeal from a criminal defendant who argued that Oklahoma lacked jurisdiction to prosecute him in the first place because the crime was committed within the Muscogee Creek Nation's reservation. And therefore, under foundational federal Indian law principles, he should have been prosecuted in the federal court instead. He argued that the boundaries of the reservation had never been disestablished, certainly not when Oklahoma became a state, but further that Congress had never taken any steps after Oklahoma statehood to take those boundaries away. And the United States Supreme Court agreed. and the majority opinion rather scathingly so with regard to Oklahoma's exercise of jurisdiction over the last 100 years. And here's the quote that I find to be so compelling. Unlawful acts performed long enough and with sufficient vigor are never enough to amend the law. To hold otherwise would be to elevate the most brazen and longstanding injustices over the law, both rewarding wrong and failing those in the right. In short, the case stands for the proposition that federal Indian law principles apply inside of Oklahoma, and there's nothing different or special about Oklahoma that would have divested the tribes in that state from the federal Indian law regime that we see everywhere else. And the court sets aside a long narrative of Oklahoma believing that they were different and thinking and acting as if colonization was somehow complete here, when the laws on the books told a quite different story. There is no such thing as Oklahoma exceptionalism. Oklahoma is, of the most part, in the same situation as other states that have Indian country and modern tribal governments inside their state. And that gets us to the questions of this evening. How did we get here in the first place? What were the stories and the narratives that were told in the mainstream or not told at all that folks would wake up three generations later and be shocked by this outcome? Who told the stories and why? What stories need to be told more fully? What gives life to myths and commonly held presumptions that are not supported by the letter of the law? And what does the actual primary source record really say? How could so many people have gotten it so wrong? Was it wishful thinking or a lack of indigenous voice, or was it both? So to tell this story in a more complete way, I'm gonna use the Cherokee Nation as the frame of reference, highlighting some things I hope you will all remember and further research on your own. Do what I did to Renard, take me to task. Make us all better scholars in the long run. Students of federal Indian law know about the importance of what are called the Cherokee cases. The Cherokee cases that most often get referred to are two of the three cases known as the Marshall Trilogy that formed the foundation of federal Indian law. Cherokee Nation versus Georgia in 1831 and Worcester versus Georgia in 1832. If you know nothing else about Indian law and you just read those two cases, you know this. State law has no force and effect inside of Indian country. And the Indian law questions are primary questions of federal law, not state law. And you know that the state of Georgia is like a piece of Swiss cheese, right? That there's a hole up at the top of the state of Georgia in the north, where although it was physically inside the state of Georgia, Cherokee Nation is carved out both legally and conceptually from the state of Georgia. Inside Cherokee Nation, that bubble, Cherokee laws applied, and that was to the exclusion of Georgia laws. And that Cherokee Nation's territory and sovereignty both existed in an inherent way, but were also federally protected. That's a lot from two cases. So the Cherokee Nation won that last case in the United States Supreme Court. And at the time, Georgia leaders were as mad and as dismissive of the United States Supreme Court's ruling as some in Oklahoma are right now. So we know this. We know that going back to Georgia and maybe now, the United States has a rule of law problem. In Worcester versus Georgia, the United States Supreme Court said one thing, but the political powers that be said something else, and we all know what happened next. No matter what the Supreme Court said, Indian removal was going to happen one way or the other. So the Indian Removal Act was actually passed before these cases were heard. It was passed in 1830. And just before that famous Cherokee case decided by the Supreme Court, that act was passed, but it was not self-executing. It was just a state of congressional intent that it would be federal policy to effectuate removal by eventually entering into negotiations with tribes, and hopefully those tribes would be pressured to legally relinquish their lands and consent to be relocated with new treaties. And that's how we get to the five tribes that are implicated. First, Muscogee Creek Nation and the victory in McGirt, and then the other four tribes. And after the Cherokee cases come out, by this time, those tribes all could see the writing on the wall. And they, in these new treaties, insisted on better guarantees this time. They insisted on and received clearly defined governmental territorial boundaries and fee title to their lands, which came in subsequent land patents and deeds. These conveyances were issued by the federal government as the grantee, with the tribes as a federal government as the grantor, with the tribes as the grantees. And the way that this happened would be the same way that you or I would own a house today, if we went out and bought a house on the market. But the tribe's fee was even stronger than that, because neither the government from the federal side or some external state could come in and exercise eminent domain or otherwise take that land. But even more, it meant that the tribal law was the exclusive law that got applied to the land as far as a land tenure system goes. And so I think that it's the most definitive type of indigenous reservation of land rights and government rights that ever existed. It wasn't just reserved by the federal government for the benefit of the tribe as a homeland. It was fully owned by the tribes. And then each of these tribes developed their own laws to govern how the system would have citizens and non-citizens interact with that territory. And we see this type of arrangement all over the globe, right? Where the underlying mineral estate is still nationalized and owned by the government, but the surface rights would allow for the perfection of individual property rights in that regime. That's what was happening in this area. So as the push for allotment started to heat up, you had the tribes with fee simple, absolute property ownership within a clearly negotiated government boundary, and the tribes were exercising pretty much full tribal dominion over the land, the minerals, and the territories pursuant to tribal property laws. And each of those did not just hold this land in common the way that history books suggest, but a push to allot those lands was, yes, about access to land and natural resource, but it was also about the erasure of tribal lifeways, tribal law, and tribal property systems. Now, the story that gets told about the allotment process is one with a very broad brush, and it goes like this. Indigenous people don't really own property the way that Americans do. They don't really use it or value the land in the way that Americans do. We need to teach them how to be property owners and value and use their land the same way as Americans do. And this is a necessary part of the process of preparing Indigenous people for eventual United States citizenship. And those two concepts very definitively go hand in hand, because with a lot of the tribes, when allotment came, so came United States citizenship. Those were pieces that were attached to each other. And I suppose that that sounds good in theory if the underlying assumptions are actually true. But what if they're not true? And what if the historical record actually tells just the opposite story? Tonight, I want to add to everyone's collective knowledge what I think are two equally important Cherokee cases, but they are the more devastating to tribal sovereignty Cherokee cases. Stevens versus Cherokee Nation, United States Supreme Court, 1899, and Cherokee Nation versus Hitchcock, 1902, also United States Supreme Court. These two cases were the path to Oklahoma statehood. And they tell a very different story about land and about oil and gas. Every American school child knows about the land run. They are told that it was a single event and that the land was vacant. And then there was Oklahoma. And there were indigenous people here, but they didn't have reservations anymore and their courts are all gone because Oklahoma. They are not told that the land run was a series of land runs and that the biggest land run was actually held in 1893, not 1889. And that land run, the 1893 one, was later ruled by the United States Claims Commission to have been illegal. It happened at the Cherokee Nation's lands in a Cherokee outlet. And the United States Claims Commission ruled that those lands were taken against the will of the Cherokee Nation for unconscionable consideration, and that the Cherokee Nation was forced to deed approximately 6 million acres of their fee land to the United States, who then immediately turned that into 40,000 United States citizens given free homesteads of 160 acres each. And that once those homesteads get their land, they wanted a state of their own as well. And that was largely what and quickly led to the state of Oklahoma. But we're not told about the role of oil and gas in this, except for that there was a big boom in Oklahoma in the early 1900s. When someone hears about the allotment process and how tribes were not probably using their lands the way Americans would, it's easy to jump to the conclusion and presume that if the tribes remained in control of land, they would have blocked all the oil and gas production, and that would have had a chilling impact on the economy. And that was part of why Oklahoma statehood and the allotment process had to take place. But what if the opposite were true? What if the Cherokee Nation played a very active role in oil and gas development, and it was their action rather than their inaction that actually led to the frenzy to allot lands and add a new state? That's exactly what happened. It wasn't that the Cherokee Nation opposed oil and gas exploration and development. It was that they were very much in the middle of it. I'd like to bring to light, as part of this public dialogue, the loss of Cherokee Nation control over mineral estate development. And I'd like to introduce you to a new name that needs a lot more research. It's Cherokee Oil and Gas Company, a company that has the excellent claim of probably being the pioneer oil and gas operator in what would eventually become the state of Oklahoma. Cherokee Oil and Gas was not a Cherokee Nation wholly owned company, as the name would suggest, but it was a company that had leased 740,000 acres from the Cherokee Nation in an oil and gas lease. It was an Arkansas corporation operating on tracts originally leased to tribal citizens inside the Cherokee Nation. Now, there was a fair amount of oil and gas activity in the area. Standard Oil was already in Kansas, and they had producing wells. And the action area that I'm talking about inside the Cherokee Nation were the Cherokee towns of Vinita, Chelsea, Tallala. And it's said that at that time, individuals inside the Cherokee Nation would sometimes need to drill three or four wells to get to water before they could find one that didn't have oil in it. So people knew that that resource was very ripe. And so there had been attempts as early as the 1880s to start introducing American corporations to become involved in Indian Territory oil resources. But those early efforts didn't succeed. There was the recognition at the time by the federal government that Cherokee Nation's own mineral laws were in effect, and that their treaty rights would prohibit the Department of Interior from getting involved. And so because the Department of Interior would not sign off on oil and gas leases inside the Cherokee Nation, it became too risky of a proposition for the outsiders to invest money. And I know that it would come, I know that it probably comes as shock to some of the Cherokees that I know are on the lecture tonight, but as you might imagine, the Cherokee Nation citizens were deeply divided on this political issue as to whether to go forward with the development or not, particularly based on what they had learned in Georgia around gold. In the first two Cherokee cases, people like to talk about the criminal law aspects of Georgia extending its laws inside the Cherokee Nation. But keep in mind that when Georgia extended their laws into the Cherokee Nation, that meant that their land lottery, and more importantly, the extension of Georgia mineral laws, would go in effect inside of Cherokee Nation too. And that had to be pushed back by the United States Supreme Court. And the popular press in the 1880s and Indian Territory also got involved. And they started pushing this communism narrative and that the Department of Interior should get involved. You know, they were in between a rock and a hard place as to what they should do. So there was also all this pressure from businessmen wanting to get at the oil, and that put a lot of pressure on the Cherokee Nation. So back to this Cherokee Oil and Gas Company, those leases that I mentioned were approved by the Cherokee Nation's legislature, the National Council, And it raised questions as to whether the tribe could unilaterally do that or not, right? Could the tribe lease its own land in oil and gas without the Department of Interior being involved? And Cherokee Nation certainly took the position that of course they could. They owned their lands in fee, and the federal government had no power to do anything in terms of approving or disapproving a lease. It was expressly and exclusively Cherokee Nation laws. So Cherokee Nation began passing a series of legislative acts designed to promote oil and gas enterprise. In 1875, the laws were part of a Cherokee Nation Business Mineral Act. And although it didn't specifically mention oil and gas, it talked about natural resources and the mineral estate. And consistent with Cherokee property laws at the time, it excluded corporations and whites. And so when a Cherokee citizen would get coal from the land that they owned the surface, the understanding was that they would apply to the Cherokee Nation and get a license and pay royalties to the Cherokee Nation for the use of that mineral estate for their own personal purposes. And so now that new resources, i.e. oil and gas, are involved, the law starts to rapidly change. People start directly soliciting the Cherokee Nation. And the chief at the time, Chief Bushyhead, got many solicitations, one most notably from Standard Oil in the early 1880s, seeking to enter into a joint venture that would make the Cherokee Nation a lot of money. So the Cherokee Nation revenue for coal at this time was pretty modest. And so the Cherokee Nation did what Cherokees do. They went with it. And there was going to be a lot of outside companies coming in and trying to bypass the Cherokee government in the licensing and otherwise. So the Cherokee Nation really grabbed the bull by the horns and started actively seeking interest to drill on Cherokee lands. So in 1883, the tribe amends their mineral laws, and they specifically for the first time mention oil and gas and royalties at a particular statutorily prescribed rate that would be owed to the Cherokee Nation. Now, leases were limited at the time to Cherokee citizens, but a citizen could enter into a joint venture also with a non-Cherokee for mining purposes. And the statute said this could happen so long as, quote, it would increase the revenue to the nation. So this idea of oil and gas leases in payable quantities was first a concept of tribal law in the Cherokee Nation long before the state of Oklahoma. The following year, the Cherokee Nation signaled that it would grant a monopoly on production, transportation, and on refinery of oil inside the Cherokee Nation to any company that would come in, enter into a contract with the tribe, and start production within a year. So the Cherokee Nation made it clear that this revenue would go to government services, building better schools for Cherokee Nation citizens. It would go to the Cherokee Nation treasury. So think about that. There's no tribal property tax of their own mineral estate because it's the tribe that owns the underlying mineral estate. So this was their way of coming up with more government revenue to fund their court systems, their schools, et cetera. The monopoly idea failed because it was difficult to get investors. And the Department of Interior at this time, as late as 1888, are still declining to approve these leases, saying the Cherokee Nation rights are fixed by treaty and they can't get involved because to do so would set a bad precedent. And so there were some investors that fell through and et cetera. Eventually the Cherokee Nation repeals the legislation, and the last revision to the Cherokee mineral oil and gas laws happened in 1890, where they approve for ingress and egress for companies to come in. They just require a larger bond to protect the interest of the Cherokee Nation. So for the first time in this last amendment, Cherokee Nation allows the authority under Cherokee law for a non-citizen corporation to come onto tribal lands. And the Cherokee Treasurer's Office starts issuing licenses to that effect. So Cherokees were in it from two angles. There's the Cherokee Nation passing legislation to deal with oil and gas development and generation of government wealth for services by the Cherokee Nation itself. And then they're in DC with lobbyists fighting any attempt that the United States might insert itself into the tribe's natural resources. Finally, in 1898, that's when the Curtis Act is passed. And it is called, ironically, an act for the protection of the people in Indian Territory and for other purposes. And it contained a mineral clause, and it provided for the first time that the United States purported to give itself authority to control natural resources and not have those be pursuant to tribal law. The rules and regulations within the Department of Interior still would not take that step until Congress came in. And so it was said that one of the purposes of this bill was to protect the masses of Indians from enterprising individuals and the Cherokee government itself. And so the version that made it out to Cherokee voters when it came time for the allotment process actually preserved all of these prior issued oil and gas leases. And it says that nothing in this act shall be held or construed to change, alter, modify, or impair any existing rights, right? So in the Cherokee Nation's allotment agreement that the tribe consented to, they preserved all of these prior oil and gas leases. So naturally, everyone starts lobbying to the Department of Interior. At this time, we are still talking about leases that are pending of over 94,000 acres of oil and gas leases that the tribe had entered into at the time. Of those 94,000, the Cherokee Oil and Gas Company only are recognized by the Department of Interior having valid leases to a little over 11,000 acres of land. And it was described by the Cherokee press at the time as the final wedge for the ultimate looting of the national estate. And the national estate was the oil and gas underlying the entire portion of the Cherokee Reservation. So Cherokee Nation sued the Department of Interior, Secretary Hitchcock at the time, in 1902 to stop him from granting any additional oil and gas leases. And the court in the Hitchcock case had a very interesting intellectual maneuver, right? They said that the Cherokees held title to their land not in fee, but only in trust, and that that trust was contingent on the Cherokee Nation being a good steward and a good trustee of Cherokee lands, and that for lack of that, the United States was stepping in to take control of Cherokee property rights. So read together, Stephen versus Cherokee Nation in 1899 and Cherokee Nation versus Hitchcock in 1902, are the start of the United States' true exercise of plenary power in Indian affairs, where they reach inside the internal workings of a tribe and try to overcome tribal determinations of citizenship and land and have federal judgment be superimposed on that. And so it's the first time that you see that internal land tenure decision preempted by federal law. So as I start to wrap up, the oil and gas frenzy expedited the allotment process and this push for Oklahoma statehood. And I need to talk very briefly about how oil and gas and the General Allotment Act came through mechanically. The five tribes were originally exempted from the allotment process altogether. It was because it was going to be too hard inside of Indian Territory. And it was going to be too hard because they had too much control over their lands and they were exercising authority in ways that maybe other tribes were not exercising, but certainly ways that the surrounding territory and the United States were uncomfortable with. And there was a clear understanding that it wasn't going to be easy to do this with the five tribes. And so what happened to compel that allotment process was that other things were threatened in the course, not just the land. It was the threat of abolishing tribal courts. It was the threat of the end of tribal existence if the tribes didn't agree to this. And so finally, each one of the tribes entered into agreements, allotment agreements, that exercised as much of control of the process as the tribes possibly could. And in the Cherokee context, one thing that I frequently see cited is that people cite the wrong allotment agreement. One was presented to the Cherokee Nation in 1901. It was rejected. Another was presented in 1902, and this is the one that the Cherokee people adopted. It had the savings clause for the oil and gas leases. It also had a savings clause for the abolition of the Cherokee Nation judiciary. And it also had a savings clause that basically unpacked all of the bad stuff about the Curtis Act with two exceptions, one dealing with limited powers of townships and the other dealing with some small taxation issues. So just as we have had to restrain people, you know, to say, yes, there are Indian reservations in Oklahoma, the same thing for the courts. A lot of this information in the Curtis Act are expressly repealed in what the Cherokee Nation people adopted. On the eve of Oklahoma statehood in 1906, not all of these deeds had been signed, and there was still this open question about all of these oil and gas leases that were hanging out there. So the worst of the allotment agreements, the death of tribal governments, never came to pass, and they were extended into perpetuity in a 1906 act. And although the tribal governments remained underground until about the 1970s, when Congress lifted their feet off of the five tribes' neck and recognized the tribes' right to elect their own leaders again and revitalize tribal governments through constitutions, all of that happened in an entanglement in oil and gas that is astonishing when you truly get into it. Now, in conclusion, I am a Cherokee Nation citizen, and I'm also a proud Oklahoman. But the 10 years that I spent in Arkansas had left a mark on me, particularly in that I met some of the best trial lawyers and oralists and storytellers that you would ever see. And in the aftermath of McGirt, when there was such outrage about the Supreme Court reaching this decision, I had to think that this was really about something besides who gets to prosecute people in a criminal case. And so if you'll think back, those that were around there, if not, Google it, to the closing of the Clinton impeachment trial, famous Arkansas statesman Dale Bumpers had an amazing trial moment close where he said, "When you hear somebody say that it's not about the money, it's about the money. When you hear someone say that it's not about the sex, it's about the sex." When you hear people in Oklahoma, either at the time of statehood or now after McGirt, say that this outrage is not about control over oil and gas and environment and mineral development and even taxes, and that all of this is to do just about criminal cases, you think you know the answer to that question. It might just be about all kinds of adjudicatory and regulatory control. And it might be a bigger, fuller story when we all keep reading and learning more about it. There's more to unpack here than Renard could have ever done in his lifetime. But he was right about many things, and one was this. When he told us that the Indian law that we would see would be different than his Indian law, he was spot on. So with that, I will leave it to the questions, and I so thank you for the invitation to be here tonight. My pleasure.
Well, thank you so much, Professor Leeds, for that absolutely fascinating and enlightening lecture. There was so much in there. It was a real privilege, and I'm looking forward to the question session with you, which I am moderating, and I'll tell the audience how to do that. For the audience, please submit questions. We have probably at least 10 minutes, I think, for questions. The way you do it is you go to your Q&A button on the bottom right-hand side of the Zoom. So while we're waiting for questions to come in, I might ask the first one, which is very, very broad, but I think it gives you an opportunity to go back through the history and reformulate. My question is, if you had a way to formulate the appropriate trust relationship between the U.S. Department of Interior and the tribes generally, what would that look like?
Well, I think that the story that I described leading up to the allotment process would be the far end of the continuum of what that doesn't look like, right? That where you have the tribe making treaty-based land and power arguments, and that the federal government steps in and not only doesn't come to the rescue of the tribe, but actually substitutes its judgment for the tribe. That certainly is not what the trust responsibility is about. I think what it is about is that if you take Indian law back to some of its beginning origins, where the trust responsibility has its genesis, it's in the Cherokee cases of the 1830s that say some type of federal protectorate over land as probably the best model that can exist if we subscribe to the power that the United States is going to have over the tribes. And where that trust responsibility comes from is that the United States must necessarily have obligations and duties if they're going to have or be coupled with that power. So translate that into modern day scenarios. It's meaningful consultation. It is subscription to international principles of prior free and informed consent. And it's just being a partner with the tribes to help them thrive instead of the reverse of that.
Terrific. Thank you. Our second question I'm going to take from our Professor Howie Arnett, who teaches federal Indian law at our law school. And this came to me actually over text. So his question is, Oklahoma is trying to get the McGirt issue back before the Supreme Court this term. Is that a possibility given the change in the court since the McGirt case?
Right, and in Oklahoma right now, that's what everybody's watching, right? The $1 million question. It would be a very unusual situation for the United States Supreme Court to overturn itself within an 18-month window or so. That's not to say that it couldn't happen, but it would be a very unusual circumstance. I also think that given the majority opinion's finding that it would require an act of Congress to change this, it would be very difficult intellectually to presume that that has happened in the time since McGirt. But there is always the possibility that the Supreme Court could come back in with a new configuration and say that the Supreme Court got it wrong. But I think that it would be a very difficult intellectual path to get to, given how the court arrived at the McGirt decision and the fact that it does not stand on its own as an outlier, but that it reaffirms Parker and the other disestablishment cases that we now have 9 of after McGirt. So it'll be interesting to see, but yes, all eyes in Oklahoma are on that piece.
Thank you. We have a question that came in. To what extent do the Bill of Rights of the United States Constitution apply in tribal territory? And to what extent should they apply?
Okay. Well, the actual Bill of Rights of the United States Constitution does not squarely apply to constrain tribal power in its exercise. And so what you're looking for when you're looking for a Bill of Rights is that you're first looking for any civil rights protections that exist at tribal law. So the tribal constitution, the tribal laws, and then as a additional buffer against due process or civil rights concerns, the United States Congress in the 60s passed the Indian Civil Rights Act by virtue of this plenary power that I think is solidified in the Stevens and Hitchcock cases, and passed a statute that says in the exercise of tribal power, at minimum, tribes have to do these certain things. And it mirrors the Bill of Rights, but it comes in statutory form in the federal code and not in the Constitution itself. The remedy, if you were to find yourself in an argument that a tribe has violated your civil rights, the remedy is habeas in the federal courts. And you don't have to wait as long to get there as you would raising those same types of arguments in a state forum.
Right, that was a good bit of federal Indian law right there. All right, the next question is, who came up with the McGirt strategy and why? Was there a team looking for a test case such as this to bring review to the issue of Indian country existing as a test case?
So this issue had been danced around for a really long time. And when it had been brought up in other contexts, be they taxation issues or otherwise, there was not a fair amount of leverage at that time. And in fact, if you look at some of the cases, particularly involving the Osage Nation, there were negative circuit court opinions that were very detrimental and could have been detrimental to other tribes as well. And so, you know, if you look at the compacts and agreements between the five tribes in the state of Oklahoma over the last 30 years, this issue has been very delicately not brought front and center. And I don't think that that's a mistake. Now, to be fair on this question, all credit goes to federal public defender Patty Gezzi and her team. You know, it is a different set of risk when you have someone on death row or serving a life sentence. And so this coming up in the context of some pretty heinous criminal activity was very scary to the tribes, because here we go once again, much like the Marshall Trilogy, where a very important question about the future legal status of five tribes at least are brought up in the context of post-conviction criminal cases, which very rarely get one. And so the tribes were able to participate. Muscogee Creek Nation was able to participate, you know, in one of the cases and as amicus in the other case. And I'm talking about the Murphy and McGirt cases, you know, read together. But I do think if we can circle back around and give kudos to Renard and the mentorship that he had of so many people in our field today, folks outside of Indian law might not understand the concerted effort that was underway when these cases made their way to the United States Supreme Court. And as part of Congress of the American Indian and the Native American Rights Fund Supreme Court project, you know, the amount of lawyers that were teaming up on this case behind the scenes and then publicly in some of these briefs, it could not have happened 10, 5, 20 years ago. It happened because there's a field of people who are now ready to fight these battles. And I think that Renard definitely played a hand in many of the mentoring of that group of people. But yes, it was an all hands on deck effort once the cases were presented. But the public defender team, you know, deserves all the credit in the initiation of that Murphy case. And then McGirt followed.
All right, this question that just came in is a very intriguing one. How do you think Renard's view of a pre-Columbian future for all of us in terms of environmental protection or as a response to climate change is reflected in the story about the control of oil and gas resources? Does Renard's view fail to recognize that a sovereign tribe may choose to develop mineral resources like oil and gas the same way a state or the federal government might? You know, I'll take the liberty of even adding on to that question. It's not my question, but I'll piggyback just to say that, of course, our climate system cannot afford more greenhouse gas emissions from fossil fuel. And so the clear scientific consensus is to decarbonize, just adding that on.
Right. You know, I think that like a lot of these cases, paint with a broad brush these legal issues, and then they get applied to very diverse tribes with very diverse cultural values, life ways, legal and political status. I think that it's really hard for scholars to do, you know, similar conversation, because They are either going to focus in on the one or two tribes that they know more about, i.e. my lecture tonight, or else they're going to paint with a broader brush this indigenous, you know, reality that might or might not fit or fully appreciate the complexity and the diversity of all tribal communities out there. So I think that particularly in his earlier writings, that's a fair critique of the broad brush, you know, that and particularly when you're comparing people over time and space, you know, that's a very difficult thing. But I think, like all of us, he put a stake in the ground there that you know, when you compare the diversity and complexity of tribal communities, it's not going to stand up every time.
Okay, here's another question. How does Oklahoma's suit against the DOI, Department of Interior, regarding the federal agency's plan to strip Oklahoma of its jurisdiction to regulate coal mining on tribal reservations fit into the narrative?
So I mentioned that this idea of Oklahoma exceptionalism, you know, has to be put aside, that Oklahoma, for the most part, is on the same footing as all the other Western states that have Indian country inside of it. I'll pull back off of that on a few points, in that there are a lot of tribally specific statutes that apply to the five tribes, and they apply to how restrictions on alienation got lifted after the allotment process, and they apply in the environmental and natural resource setting. And so whether that's Midnight Riders that get attached to Clean Water Act legislation, or that get attached to transportation around clean water, or, you know, there are some of these specific statutes that give over very expressly powers to the state of Oklahoma that other tribe or other states don't have. So one example is, you know, the probate in Oklahoma goes to the county courts instead of the rest of Indian country. Those probates, particularly if they're on trust land, they're going to go through the interior processes. So there are some arguments about regulatory jurisdiction when it comes to natural resources, oil and gas particular, possibly on the mining. But I think that you're just going to be in for a ride of several cases challenging and asking the question about what did this particular statute mean and how does that interface with the others. So I wouldn't go as far to say that Oklahoma is going to lose all of the mining, oil and gas type litigation, because there are some legitimate situations where Congress is clear that they gave powers over to the state. But I think that based on McGirt, if McGirt is applied in the lower cases, lower federal courts and circuit courts, if your starting presumption is that tribes never lost this, and we need express language that clearly hands over this power to Oklahoma, we've got a framework to deal with now, where before Oklahoma just presumed that they had the power to do everything, even over trust land. And so over time that gets drawn back. And you know, I wanna you know, clarify that as much as everything rests on McGirt this moment, I describe McGirt as Oklahoma Indian 2.0, right? Because we had a number of cases in the 80s and early 90s where Oklahoma was pushed back from their exercise of criminal jurisdiction over restricted and trust property. They were exercising this jurisdiction everywhere. So phase one was no as to the Indian country land that's still held in trust and restricted. Phase two was, and also the boundaries were still there. So this wasn't as much of a bombshell. It's been this chipping away over time at that presumptive default Oklahoma jurisdiction.
Wonderful. We have time for, I think, one more short question. Okay. And that is, can you identify any clear implications of McGirt that don't involve criminal jurisdiction? So it's kind of a nice follow-up on what you just said, and we'll conclude the program after this.
I think that it has to be various types of taxation, not all taxation, but various types of taxation. I think that it's pretty clear through the federal case law that once land loses all restricted status, the states can probably tax the ad valorem property without that being jeopardized. So I think nothing in McGirt speaks to any change in the tax status when it comes to paying tax on property. I do think that federal Indian law has been very clear for a very long time about income tax and taxing the income of individuals who are tribal citizens who live and earn their income inside their tribe's boundaries. I can't see a situation where at the end of the day, Oklahoma prevails on that question. Unless the Supreme Court said the boundaries aren't there anymore, right? That would change everything. But if we move forward with the understanding that the reservation boundaries are still intact, then it's very, very strong as far as the federal case law on the income tax question.
Well, unfortunately, we are at the end of our program time. This has been such an intriguing and insightful journey, both in history and in law. And we cannot thank you enough, Professor Leeds, for this fabulous lecture. And I want to also thank the audience for participating tonight. And we'll note that a recording of this lecture will be posted on our website at the Environmental and Natural Resources Law Center at University of Oregon School of Law. And that concludes our program for this evening. Good night.